It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Public elementary and French teachers are still without a contract, and this government has walked away from the table. And yesterday it became clear the government has made no progress in ending the education chaos they've created. Parents of young children are left in the dark. 5 days isn't enough time to make different childcare arrangements to find a daycare space. Parents deserve certainty. Children do not deserve this uncertainty, and that's exactly what the Liberal government is giving them. Mr. Speaker, after a year without a contract, how can the Premier...
And that will end it. Thank you. Please finish.
Mr. Speaker, after a year without a contract, how can the Premier continue to leave parents wondering if their children will be in the classroom?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I think that everyone in this House knows that we were all pleased that all of our students were in school, our teachers and support staff were in school the day after Labor Day, Mr. Speaker. And we've worked very, very hard to find agreements with all the federations. We are in a situation where there are tentative agreements with OECTA, Mr. Speaker, and with the Ontario Secondary School Teachers Federation. And that's a very, very good thing. Mr. Speaker, we have worked hard to negotiate with the Elementary Teachers Federation of Ontario. There are dates that have been set for the French teachers' negotiations for those to continue, Mr. Speaker. We will continue to work hard to find those agreements within the parameters of what has been put in place for the other teachers, Mr. Speaker. I think that that's reasonable. That is exactly what we said.
Answer.
We said that there was a difficult fiscal situation. We've been able to find agreements
Thank
with
you.
The secondary teachers in OECTA.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the government walked away from the table. We don't know how long before a full-blown strike. We don't know how long before extracurriculars are cancelled. The Liberals continue to use students and parents as their pawns. It won't be long before elementary schools will cancel services the kids cherish, like sports clubs, plays, field trips, all will be gone. All gone because the government is not in it for the students. Mr. Speaker, we don't need a part-time premier. Instead of spending her time being distracted by partisan federal campaign activities, Mr. Speaker, when will the premier do her job and get a deal done?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Stop that. It goes both ways.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I will say to the Leader of the Opposition, I think he will know that I had a meeting in the middle of the summer with all of the components, with all of the, you know, Mr. Speaker, the heckling from across the way about the federal election, I just want to be perfectly clear. This has absolutely nothing to do with the federal election. Our children being in school is about our kids having the opportunity to learn. The education system in this province, Mr. Speaker, is one of the most important things that this government has responsibility for. I will remind the member opposite that the reason that I and many of my colleagues in this caucus are involved in provincial politics because of the turmoil that was in place when my children were in school, Mr. Speaker. That's what compelled me to get involved in provincial politics.
You see it, please. You see it, please.
Yeah,
that's all it's
Start the clock. Final. Government House Leader, come to order. Opposition House Leader, come to order. You could get one too, that would be two.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier. The Liberal government is responsible for the longest strike in over 25 years. And before that, just 2 years ago, thousands of students lost their extracurricular activities. Now, parents and children are left wondering what other hardships the Liberal government...
Start the clock. Finish, please.
Well, the Liberal government has slashed thousands of daycare spots, leaving parents with nowhere to turn if classes are indeed cancelled. Ontario families deserve certainty. The part-time Premier to stop being distracted and focus on doing her job. Mr. Speaker, why does the Premier care so little about parents who are scrambling to find daycare spots?
My attempts have been to try to ask for quiet in a very quiet way. So from now on, I'm going to move immediately into warnings of individuals. That's it. You asked for it, you're getting it. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I think my helpful team told me that I misspoke.
The member from Nepean Carleton is warned. Premier.
Said that this issue had nothing to do with the provincial election. I meant with the federal election, Mr. Speaker. This has to do with children being in school, Mr. Speaker. You know, I have a granddaughter who started grade one this year, and I have a granddaughter who started junior kindergarten, full day kindergarten. This is her first week of full day kindergarten, and Mr. Speaker, there's nothing dearer to my heart than making sure that our publicly funded education system is working, Mr. Speaker, and that.
The Minister of Agriculture is warned. Carry on.
It means having all of our kids in school. It means having all of our teachers and all of our support staff in school, which is why I was so pleased that we were able to come to tentative agreements.
Answer.
With the WECTA and OSSTF. We'll get there with the.
Thank you. The member from Dufferin-Caledon is warned. New question. New question. Leader of the Opposition.
My question for the Premier. Across the province, Simcoe North, I heard a common theme, trust. And the Premier has lost the trust of families in Ontario because of her fire sale of Hydro One. By turning the back on independent oversight, the Premier has lost the province's trust. The Premier barred 8 independent officers from doing their jobs before the Hydro One fire sale even began. The Premier, isn't this deal for taxpayers? Mr. Speaker, the Premier has turned the lights off on accountability. Will the Premier restore independent oversight to her fire sale of Hydro One?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, let me just go through the ways that this has been a transparent process and that oversight is in place. And, Mr. Speaker, I would say to the member opposite, as I said yesterday, that what the broadening of the ownership of Hydro One is about finding a way to invest in the infrastructure that we know we need across this province, Mr. Speaker. And I understand that the Leader of the Opposition doesn't support the investment in infrastructure, but we know it's necessary, whether it's roads, bridges or transit, Mr. Speaker, across the province. So, throughout this entire process, we have been open and transparent. Let me just start. The plan was included in our 2014 budget and in the 2014 Liberal platform, Mr. Speaker. The advisory council that we asked to give us advice on this issued an interim report and a final report.
The leader of the third party is warned. Finish.
Both were publicly available, and we held a technical briefing, Mr. Speaker, for both opposition parties and for the media to give them the technical information about this process.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, the people of Ontario should be able to trust their government. Sadly, that trust has been eroded by years of shady deals. Gas plants, Orange, eHealth. In fact, I don't think the Premier even has the trust of her own cabinet, especially when hearing the words of the Chair of Cabinet, the Deputy House Leader, the member from St. Catharines, who said, anyone who looks at the Hydro One would recognize that is best kept in public ownership and public hands. Anyone who sells their largest one of their largest revenue tools is headed towards bankruptcy. Mr. Speaker, if the Premier can't gain the confidence of her own cabinet, how can the people of Ontario expect her to manage this fire sale?
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, as I think I said to the leader of the third party at one point, I think we should all just deal with our own teams, Mr. Speaker, and we have a very cohesive team. I want to talk a little bit more about the transparency and oversight that we've put in place. We brought in Denis Deshotels, Mr. Speaker, who is the former Auditor General of Canada, to oversee the IPO. The member opposite knows that publicly traded companies are subject to different oversight mechanisms than Crown corporations. I think he knows that full well because he, in the past, has been very supportive of the private sector. Mr. Speaker. In fact, he has said that he believes that the private sector often works better than government and knows how to run business, Mr. Speaker. Hydro One will be regulated by the Ontario Business Corporations Act, the Ontario Securities Act, and the Ontario Energy Board. They'll have to file information with the Ontario Securities Commission and disclose the compensation of their top executives. Mr. Speaker, there are oversight provisions in place. They are solid, Mr. Speaker. They will provide the information that the people of Ontario need.
Final supplement.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, it's not just the independent officers concerned. Over 70% of the people of the province have made it clear they don't welcome the Ontario, the Hydro One fire sale. The people of Ontario do not approve of a deal being done in secret while you delay the prospectus. The people of Ontario deserve to have their government watchdogs at work. The protection the watchdogs offered in the past found millions and over billions, discovered the billions squandered with the smart meters. Those same watchdogs deserve to be able to do their job to protect taxpayers under this fire sale. Mr. Speaker, when will the Premier return oversight, real oversight, by the independent officers of Parliament to her fire sale?
Thank you. Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, you know, the Leader of the Opposition uses an interesting term when he talks about a fire sale. And I will just say, Mr. Speaker, that one of the guiding principles that we held on to as we went into this process was that we would not do what had been done by that party with the 407, Mr. Speaker. We made it very clear that it was extremely important for the government and the people of Ontario to retain ownership, Mr. Speaker, retaining 40% ownership, making sure that we retain control of the board, Mr. Speaker, in terms of being able to remove the board, being able to remove the CEO, and making sure that no entity could own more than 10%, Mr. Speaker. None of those provisions was in place when the 407 deal was put in place, Mr. Speaker. None of those protections, Mr. Speaker, the regulation of the sector in terms of the OEB setting rates, that remains in place. I'm not going to take lessons from the opposition, Mr. Speaker. About
Sincerely, please. Thank you. The time does not arrest my original words. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you so much, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. The Premier has promised again and again to be open and transparent with the people of Ontario, Speaker, but the sale of Hydro One is shrouded in secrecy. Only the Premier and her powerful friends know the details behind this sale. And only the Premier and her powerful friends know how fast hydro rates will skyrocket. Why is this Premier breaking her promise to be open, transparent and accountable to the people of Ontario, the very people, Speaker, who own Hydro One?
So, Mr. Speaker, again, let me just address the two parts of that question. First of all, the leader of the third party knows full well that the way electricity rates are set now is the way electricity rates will be set in the future, and that is the Ontario Energy Board sets those rates, Mr. Speaker, and she knows full well that the Ontario Energy Board has received applications for rate reductions, has received applications for rate increases, and the Ontario Energy Board makes those decisions. But on the transparency of this process, Mr. Speaker, let me just again go through what we have done to ensure that there is transparency, that there is openness. Mr. Speaker, we have put in place the Denis Desautels, who was the former AG of Canada, oversee the IPO. Hydro One will be regulated, and Mr. Speaker, I know the leader of the third party knows this, by Ontario Business Corporations Act, the Ontario Securities Act, and the Ontario Energy Board. They will have to file information with the Ontario Securities Commission. Mr. Speaker, there are protections in place, there is oversight in place, and that is as it should be.
Has pulled an iron curtain over Hydro One. Now, those aren't my words, Speaker. Those are not my words. That is how the Globe and Mail described it on June the 2nd. In fact, the Premier has gone so far to undermine accountability that all of the independent officers of this legislature, save for the electoral officer, stood up to her move and said that this was the wrong thing to do. They said this was an unprecedented plan and that it was the wrong thing to do. Now she's refusing to listen to the Chamber of Commerce, Speaker, and provide concrete evidence that hydro rates will not rise as a result of this sell-off scheme. So why is the Premier doing everything that she can to avoid transparency and accountability when it comes to the privatization of Hydro One?
We are broadening the ownership of Hydro One. The people of Ontario and the government will retain 40% ownership, Mr. Speaker. No entity will be able to own more than 10%. We are doing that, Mr. Speaker, because we know that it is critical at this point in our history in this province to invest in infrastructure around the province. It is critical that we invest in the roads and the bridges and the other large infrastructure across the province that is needed by communities in order for them to be able to thrive. Now, the leader of the third party doesn't like that investment. She has not been supportive of the transit investments. She has not been supportive of the infrastructure investments across the province. But the fact is, Mr. Speaker, that we know that those are needed. We know that the Hamilton LRT, Mr. Speaker, we know that roads and bridges in Kenora and in Thunder Bay, Mr. Speaker, in Sudbury, that those are all needed if those communities are going to thrive. We're going to make those investments. That's what this is about, Mr. Speaker.
Final supplementary.
In the last election, the Premier's platform said that, quote, strong leadership means making Ontario more open and democratic, end quote. But the Premier's leadership has meant breaking promises and ignoring Ontarians who overwhelmingly reject this scheme to sell off Hydro One. This is the Premier who stripped Hydro One of public oversight. This is the Premier who removed the Ombudsman's power to help consumers at Hydro One. And this is the Premier who refuses to fully cooperate with the Financial Accountability Officer, Speaker. Will this Premier admit that accountability and transparency are only the first things that Ontarians are going to lose with the sell-off of Hydro One? You know, Mr. Speaker, the leader of the third party understands, I know, because she supported the legislation when we talk about the Financial Accountability Officer.
She supported the legislation that gave the Financial Accountability Officer authority within parameters, and we are operating within those parameters, Mr. Speaker. We are following all of the rules around that accountability to the Financial Accountability Officer, and when he has asked for information, we have given him the information within those parameters. and she knows that full well, Mr. Speaker. I know she doesn't like the idea of broadening the ownership of Hydro One. Yep. I get that. Yep. I absolutely get that. But the fact is, Mr. Speaker, that we had, as government, to make a choice. We had to make a choice about whether we were going to go ahead and make investments in infrastructure or not. And we know that for the economic well-being of this province, we need to make those investments. They need to be made across the country, but we are going ahead.
Thank you. New question? The Leader of the Third Party.
So for the Premier, public opposition, not just my opposition, Speaker, but public opposition to Hydro One is growing by the day in this province. People are disappointed by this Premier's broken promises and frustrated by her refusal to hear what Ontarians have to say. The prospectus was supposed to be released within this month, but so far it's nowhere to be seen. And the owners of Hydro One, the actual people of Ontario who own Hydro One, still have no idea what they're going to find when that prospectus is finally released, Speaker. Why does this Premier think that the owners of Hydro One should be in that position? Why does she think that the owners of Hydro One should be left in the dark?
Well, Mr. Speaker, they won't be, and I think, again, we've always said that the Hydro One prospectus would be filed with the OSC this fiscal year, and it will be, Mr. Speaker. That was our commitment, and it will be filed.
I guess the question I would want to ask the Leader of the Third Party is why she doesn't support the investment of infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. Why she doesn't understand that if we don't take this opportunity right now to have a vision for the economic viability and competitiveness and prosperity of this province, Mr. Speaker, why she doesn't understand that that will shortchange our children and our grandchildren, Mr. Speaker. That will not set us up to be competitive globally. When I traveled to China last year, Mr. Speaker, I heard over and over again concerns about our investments in infrastructure and were we going to be able to compete and were we going to be able to continue to draw foreign direct investment if we didn't make those investments. We're going to make those investments, Mr. Speaker. Part of that was reviewing our assets, and that's what we did, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
It would be sadly embarrassing to be the only Premier in the history of this province that can't keep Hydro One public while at the same time investing in infrastructure for the people of Ontario. This Premier has promised, Speaker, that the government will retain de facto control over a privatized Hydro One. But Ed Clark promised private investors that they will be in control, Speaker. The Premier says one thing, her special advisor says exactly the opposite, Speaker. So when will the Premier finally show us in writing who it is we should believe?
So, Mr. Speaker, you know, again, the Leader of the Third Party ran pretty much on our fiscal plan in the last election, and she said, she actually said on May 7th of this year, and I quote Andrea Horvath, so there's no doubt we did talk in our platform about looking at some of the physical assets that the province owns. I mean, you can never be closed-minded about that, unquote. But, Mr. Speaker,
the member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke is warned.
Let history judge our government on our investments. So when the historians look back and see that we electrified the Barrie Line, the Kitchener Line, the Lakeshore East Line, Mr. Speaker, that we built the Hamilton LRT, that we built the new alignment of Highway 7 between Kitchener and Guelph, that we put improvements in place for Highway 417 in Ottawa and in London, that we built the Mailey Drive extension in Sudbury, that we four-laned the highway between Thunder Bay and Nipissing, Mr. Speaker, and we put the second phase of the up.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Ontarians overwhelmingly reject the Premier's sell-off of Hydro One. That is the fact. That is the fact, Speaker. They want to be listened to, they want information, and they want the Premier to stop this $9 billion privatization scheme. This morning, I agreed that I would meet with the Premier to talk about these concerns and explore how together we can actually ensure that this is a fully informed public debate on the sale of Hydro One, including public hearing, Speaker, including independent analysis of the government's decision. That's what I would like to see, and I'm hoping that we can have that meeting to discuss those very things, because that's what Ontarians expect, Speaker. They expect to be heard. They expect public processes.
Question.
They deserve that, Speaker. So, will the Premier agree to meet with me to talk about this issue before this sale goes any further?
Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Premier.
Speaker, since I sent the Leader of the Third Party the letter asking for the meeting, yes, I will meet with her. And Mr. Speaker, I've got your response. Happy to meet with you. And, Mr. Speaker, at that meeting, I'm happy to talk about Hydro One, and I'm also happy to talk, Mr. Speaker, about the investments that we are making in infrastructure. And I hope that the Leader of the Third Party will be willing to talk to me about her vision for reducing greenhouse gas emissions, Mr. Speaker, for investing in transit and transportation infrastructure that will help us along that way, Mr. Speaker, and will allow for the economic prosperity of communities around the province. Those are very important parts of our plan, Mr. Speaker, and I'd be interested to hear her perspective on those.
Thank you. New question. The member from Nipissing.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. All summer long, fiscal alarm bells were ringing. Here's a sample of media headlines from just over a one-week period in July. Maclean's magazine, S&P downgrades Ontario credit rating. Financial Post, Ontario's job killer. Business sounds the alarm over soaring electricity prices. Globe and Mail, Fiat Chrysler CEO fires warning shot at Ontario. Toronto Sun, Hydro One goes dark. The Toronto Star, Ontario falls short on auto insurance. That was a heck of a week, Premier. You've put business, family, and seniors in jeopardy. Why can everyone see this but you?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the question because the member opposite is talking about where Ontario is going, recognizing the challenges that Ontario and Canada and the world have faced over the last number of years through the global recession. And yet, economists now predict that Ontario will lead Canada. Economists recognize that Ontario has done a tremendous job of increasing employment, over 565,000 net new jobs since the recession. And Canada recognizes that we must stimulate growth. The federal government and the member of the Leader of the Opposition wasn't there for us when we needed that stimulus. Ontario did stand up, Ontario did invest, and now we have the lowest unemployment per, in relation to the rest of Canada. We will continue to lead. We recognize more needs to be done, and we will do
Thank
so.
You.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Back to the Premier. On your fifth downgrade, S&P warned, quote, Ontario is a sustained and projected underperformer. The Ontario Chamber cautioned that soaring electricity prices have reached a crisis point.
The member from Trinity Spadina is warned. Finished.
Said 1 in 20 businesses is expected to shut their doors. The CEO of Fiat Chrysler told you that Ontario risks further reducing its competitive position with your pension tax and your cap and trade tax. And instead of achieving a 15% insurance rate reduction, you failed to even hit 7%. Ontario was once the economic engine of Confederation, but Liberal bungling of every single financial issue has reduced us to a have-not province, Speaker. When are you going to stop driving business out of Ontario and start listening to the experts?
Minister. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
That was a different
Well, here's what some experts have to say, and the most important expert of all, Mr. Speaker, are the investors.
Sure.
Ontario has become the top destination anywhere in North America for foreign direct investment, beating out California, Texas, New York, and every other province. And here's what some of the rating agencies do have to say, and they said as follows. Fitch stated that Ontario has demonstrated the ability to exert considerable ongoing expenditure restraint while instituting revenue changes as necessary to achieve its deficit reduction objectives. Moody's noted that our prudent debt management, large diversified economy, and significant flexibility in financial management. And DBRS said that our rating of affirmation is supported by Ontario's continued adherence to its fiscal recovery plan targets and DBRS belief that it is increasingly likely that our fiscal balance will be restored as planned. Ontario will continue to address the deficit, will continue to stimulate the economy, and will balance by 2017-18, Mr. Speaker, because the people of Ontario expect their government to be there with them as we proceed going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. No question, member from Windsor West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. For over a year, this Liberal government has failed to reach new collective agreements with thousands of teachers and education workers across Ontario. And now, the Liberals have failed again by allowing talks to collapse with elementary teachers. Real negotiating means being at the table. It means working in a genuine and meaningful way to reach a deal. It doesn't mean that a government tries to impose deals, and it doesn't mean that a government walks away from bargaining. Will the Premier instruct her Minister of Education to get back to the table and get back to meaningful negotiations before the end of today?
Thank you.
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you very much. So let me tell you what's been going on over the last year. In fact, over the last year, we've spent well over 1,000 hours negotiating with OECTA, the Ontario English Catholic Teachers, and we have a tentative agreement. We've spent well over 1,000 hours negotiating with OSSTF, and we have a tentative agreement as a result of those negotiations. So I totally reject the notion that we haven't been negotiating. We have been negotiating, and we have got a tentative agreement. We also will be resuming our negotiations tomorrow with our Francophone teachers. We've spent hundreds and hundreds of hours with our Francophone teachers. We have been working with anybody who wanted to come to the table to make sure that we have agreement.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to note that the Education Minister has also neglected 55,000 education workers with CUPE this last year. Parents and students are frustrated and disappointed with the Premier. For over a year, this Liberal government has failed to reach new agreements that protect the quality of our children's education and respect all of our teachers and education workers. The only way to reach those agreements is to show leadership, get back to the bargaining table, and negotiate in a genuine and meaningful way. Why won't the Premier do the right thing, restart negotiations, and send her minister back to the bargaining table today?
Thank you. Minister?
Thank you very much. And I do want to note that we do value our relationship with our education workers. We, in fact, have been actively negotiating with CUPE, which represents a number of the education workers. We continue to negotiate with CUPE. They've been there. We've had a lot of hours, a lot of days with CUPE over the last several weeks. So we are actively negotiating with our education workers. But we are concerned that in the case of the elementary teachers in the English public system, that they did leave the table last May 11th. They have come back recently. They came back September the 1st. And when we had a chance to talk to them, we wanted to expedite the process to make sure we protect our students' education. And
we
did offer them a settlement similar.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Sudbury.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question this morning is for the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry. Mr. Speaker, this summer my riding of Sudbury and the surrounding area has seen a significant increase in black bear sightings. Already this year there have been over 2,000 calls to the Ministry's bear reporting line, This is an increase from the 1,400 calls reported in 2014. Mr. Speaker, last week I organized a meeting with the local municipal leaders, the police service, and the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry to discuss black bear management. Constituents in my riding are concerned about the increase in bear sightings in the community and want to know what is being done to ensure public safety. So, Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry, can the minister please explain what is your ministry's role when it comes to managing black bear encounters?
Minister.
Speaker, thank you, Speaker. And I want to thank Speaker, the member, for his question. I know that this has been a difficult summer for him and for his community of Sudbury in regard to this particular issue, and I want to thank the member for his advocacy on this particular file. Speaker, on this issue, of course, public safety is the number one priority for our government when it comes to black bear management in the province of Ontario. You, your family, your property, in any circumstance where you feel threatened, the first and appropriate response is 911. There's been no equivocation from our government under any circumstances. That is absolutely the first thing that you should do. Once they're on the scene, Speaker, the police have the ability, where they feel it's necessary in certain circumstances, to call the MNRF for further support on this file. That happens on occasion. But we want to be clear, Speaker, the police agency is absolutely the appropriate response as a first responder in any emergency situation, including black bears. So I want to thank the member for his advocacy on this issue, Speaker. And there's more to say in the supplementary. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry for that answer. Recent meetings with municipal leaders in the local police service and the MNRF representatives are a positive step in coordinating our response efforts to bear encounters in my community. Mr. Speaker, constituents in my riding have asked what options are available to address bear counters. Some have suggested that trapping is an option. Others claim that MNRF needs more resources. Mr. Speaker, I understand that our government has invested over $35.3 million to educate Ontarians on ways to prevent bear encounters, and no other jurisdiction has invested as much as Ontario in teaching people about how to prevent bear encounters. So, Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, can the minister please explain what his ministry is doing to address all of these bear encounters?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Speaker, thank you, and again thank the member for the question. I want to start by addressing the resourcing issue, Speaker. I know that the third party has been in Northern Ontario this summer suggesting that the issue related to black bears is a result of declining resources from our ministry. I would remind especially Northern Ontarios that it was the NDP when in government that cut the MNR budget by some 21%, Speaker. I would further remind people that when the Conservatives came into power, they additionally cut a further 21% from MNR budget. Speaker, since 2003 or 2004, our Liberal government has increased the budget of MNRF by some $200 million. So I think it's important for people to know that. Speaker, obviously, I would add in terms of the member's question, on the trapping issue, some see this as a response. The science has been pretty clear. It is not an effective bear management tool. Oftentimes, the animals are trapped and relocated, returned to the area from which they came. And, Speaker, quite frankly, trapping does not deal with the emergent situation when people feel they're threatened and their health and safety is threatened. So, thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Before I entertain the next question, the bantering that's going on is disruptive, and somebody has a W, so I don't think I would want to continue. Member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Minister, on October 1st, the Ministry will slash another $235 million from physician services at a time when Ontario's population is growing and struggling to find a doctor, at a time when our aging population requires more help, more time with frontline services, and more complex care. Minister, you're turning your back on doctors and the patients they care for. How can you continue to insist you're fully funding health care when you continue to make cuts to doctors, nurses, and pharmacists?
District Health Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the first question coming from my new PC party health critic. I welcome the questions. I welcome the ones to come. And I think the member opposite knows, because he's from the health sector himself, that We negotiated with our doctors for more than a year, and we used a framework, in fact, for those negotiations that was agreed to by both parties. We brought in a facilitator, Dr. David Naylor, to try and bring the two parties together. We brought in retired Judge Warren Winkler as a conciliator to try to reach an agreement, and in fact, it was Warren Winkler's recommendation to the government and to the OMA that the OMA accept the government's reasonable offer. Unfortunately, the OMA decided not to accept that offer, and as the framework that both parties had agreed to provides for, we continue to implement that framework and made the changes that Warren Winkler had actually recommended to both parties.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Next speaker, back to the minister. Minister, you're asking doctors to foot the bill for medical care your government should be covering. We know you tried to hide the $54 million cut in the health care budget. The deal you forced on Ontario's doctors is restricting access to care for those in need. Doctors know how much their patients need them, and you aren't allowing them to do their job. These cuts will impact care in the future, as doctors will retire or leave the province instead of continuing to work in Ontario. Minister, how can you justify these cuts when so many patients are in need?
Well, Mr. Speaker, as this legislature knows, not only am I a physician, but I have nothing but the greatest respect for the doctors that practice in this province. They are the best in Canada, and they are among the best in terms of compensation in Canada, as well as they should be. But what I think disturbs me a little bit is the OMA has characterized this about the provision of health services to Ontarians, that somehow we're cutting services that are available to Ontarians. And nothing could be further from the truth, Mr. Speaker. In fact, these negotiations have only been about one thing. They've been about compensation to physicians, compensation that over the past 10 years, roughly, we've seen an increase in physician compensation from the government of roughly 70%. So we're asking our physicians to take a pause in that. We've had to make a modest reduction to the compensation that they receive, but it enables us to continue to fund and indeed expand our funding to areas like home care, our personal support workers, and others.
Okay, a new question. The member from Essex.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Speaker, today the Globe and Mail reported that an Infrastructure Ontario executive admitted in February 2011 to taking part in a $1.2 million kickback scheme, and at least one senior official executive at Infrastructure Ontario knew about this admission. Despite this, the executive was later hired to oversee St. Michael's Hospital's $300 million patient centre construction project. Apparently, the hospital was unaware of this executive's admitted role and involvement in the kickback scheme. Speaker, why didn't the Infrastructure Ontario executives let anybody know that one of their top executives had admitted to fraud?
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Minister.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the member for the question. It is a question, I think, that's a very serious one and one that we take very seriously. I can assure you that Infrastructure Ontario also shares those concerns, and they've taken action right from learning of this particular challenge. The first thing they did is retain an external law firm to review the procurement process with St. Michael's Hospital project, which is important. They immediately informed the chair and vice chair of their board of directors, which was important. They immediately informed my ministry, which was also an important act for them to take. They've written to the CEO of St. Michael's Hospital requesting that the employee in question be removed from the project, which has since been done. And just as importantly, IO has also just initiated a process to retain an independent firm to investigate the employment and the departure of this employee. I thank the member for the question. It's a serious issue.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, it seems, unfortunately, Infrastructure Ontario has taken action immediately 4 years after the fact, which is a serious problem. Speaker, the Globe investigation revealed that Infrastructure Ontario's chief risk officer knew about the kickback scheme as early as January 2012. The risk officer reported directly to the CEO of Infrastructure Ontario, David Livingston. In May of 2012, Mr. Livingston left Ontario, Infrastructure Ontario, to become Dalton McGuinty's chief of staff. Speaker, did Mr. Livingston or anybody else in Infrastructure Ontario know anything about this infrastructure, this kickback scheme, and did they inform anybody within the ministry?
Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I think the questions raised by the member are legitimate questions, and I think that's why it's important that Infrastructure Ontario has brought forward an independent advisor, an independent firm to investigate the issue. There are serious issues here, and to the best of our knowledge, the board had not been informed of this, of the particular circumstances around this individual, which is something that I think is open to question. So I take the matter seriously. Infrastructure Ontario takes the matter seriously, and indeed we look forward to determining. While the actions taken by this individual, the alleged actions, were outside of his capacity as an employee of IO, the fact is he was an employee of IO at the time, and we want to make sure there are no discrepancies during his time employed by IO.
Thank you. New question, the member from Eglinton Lawrence.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the minister responsible for poverty reduction. This morning, Minister, you made an important announcement at FoodShare, a nonprofit that works with communities and schools to deliver healthy food and food education as part of the local poverty reduction fund. Minister, you announced that the fund will help FoodShare evaluate two existing programs, the Good Food Program and the Urban Agricultural Program, and measure their success in improving the quality of life for those living in poverty. It would also help FoodShare determine how it can expand its program and bring good, healthy food to more communities in need. I know that the fund is an important part of our second poverty reduction program that will make sure programs improve people's lives and better focus our poverty reduction targets.
Question.
Speaker, could the minister please tell the House about this new local poverty reduction fund?
Thank you. Minister responsible for poverty reduction.
That is an excellent question. I do want to thank the member from Eglinton Lawrence for his ongoing commitment to improving the lives of people in his community and well beyond. I was delighted this morning to be in the riding of Davenport with the member at FoodShare to announce one of the successful projects in our local poverty reduction fund. Speaker, the local poverty reduction fund was established as part of our second poverty reduction strategy. It's a $50 million investment over 6 years in innovative community-based projects that measurably improve the lives of people. We announced the fund in April with an initial expression of interest, followed by a formal call for proposals in May. We've made quick progress. 233 applications were received, and we are now starting to announce the successful 41 projects. Speaker, these community-based projects we've heard are strong, and we want to measure.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, with this poverty reduction fund, it seems it will help nonprofits like FoodShare make a significant difference in people's lives across Ontario, and with this fund offering help for people living in poverty. You emphasize evaluation and gathering evidence about poverty reduction strategies. The fund emphasized the importance of reviewing and focusing our poverty programs, which will help us deliver results in our communities. Minister, why is it so important that the local poverty reduction fund focus on results and outcomes?
Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, and the member from Eglinton Lawrence is correct. This fund is unique. With this fund, we will do things differently. We want to tap into innovative local solutions. We want to build unlikely community partnerships and ultimately establish a new way of tackling poverty, one that's rooted in investment. In short, Speaker, this is about impact investing. It's about spending our precious dollars where they make the difference.
The member from Timmins, James Bay, is warned. Finish, please.
Where those investments will make the biggest difference in the lives of individuals. Reducing poverty means investing in the right supports. It's more important than ever to make sure that our dollars are getting measurable results, to focus on evidence-based funding for initiatives that work. That's why we're placing a strong emphasis on evaluation and evidence with this fund. Many studies have been conducted on poverty, Speaker, but we're lacking is evaluation.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Lennox and Addington.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Attorney General. Minister, you are the Chief Law Officer of the Province of Ontario, responsible for the administration of justice in all our courts. Your ministry is spending millions on programs to improve access and efficiency, such as the Better Justice Together program. Last week, the City of Toronto dismissed over 800,000 provincial offences dating back to 2002. Wow. Another reason these cases were dismissed was that it would cost $23 million to collect the outstanding $20 million in fines. Municipalities require these revenues to pay for needed services to the public. These cases demonstrate beyond a reasonable doubt that the administration of justice, your responsibility, is failing. Minister, will you correct these failings, or can we expect more provincial offences to be dismissed to meet your efficiency
Question?
Targets?
Thank you. Attorney General.
Yes, Mr. Speaker. First of all, I wanted to thank my friend for being appointed my critic, and I hope that I will make your job easy. So this is a very important matter that my friend is raising. You know, this is a process that is administered by the municipality. The municipality took the decision to not proceed with those because they made an administrative decision that it was more costly for them to pursue these parking tickets, and they decided to just write it off. So it's their decision. So, but access to justice is very important. I wanted to make sure that we make it easy for people to access to justice, and I'm going to continue to work with municipality to do exactly that.
Again, to the Attorney General. Minister, the administration of justice is being brought into disrepute. It is clear that either we have too few courts or far too many laws for your ministry to administer in a competent and able fashion. Earlier this year, your ministry proposed creating an administrative monetary penalty system, AMPS for short, which would deny people access to the courts and prevent them from defending themselves when charged with a provincial offence. Minister, is this how you intend to solve the problem of costly administration and lack of court space? By eroding and removing the hallmark of our justice system, the right to defend oneself before an impartial judge?
Thank you. Attorney General.
Mr. Speaker, the member is raising a good question, but I can assure you that we first of all just launched a consultation. We have received numerous opinion on it, so we are reviewing all these comments, and I want to thank all of those who participated. And one thing that I want to ensure you, that everybody will be treated fairly, and if they wanted to challenge the decision of this tribunal, or we have not decided where we are moving forward, but they will have the. I can assure them that they will be able to appeal the decision. Thank you very much.
The question, the member from Hamilton East, Stony Creek.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. 12,000 pensioners of U.S. Steel, formerly Stelco, and their families, who've been building lives and communities for decades in Hamilton, Stony Creek, Welland, and Nanticoke, are under threat. They have been told by the judge overseeing the credit protection process that the court has no ability to ensure that the pensioners will get what's owed to them ahead of the U.S. parent company, which, in a terrible situation, as predicted, is raiding the corporation, removing parts, heading back to the States, and scrapping the parts in Hamilton. Outrageous. Many of these pensioners may not outlive this process and are living in fear for their retirement security. What is this government doing
Question?
To stop the further raid of U.S. Steel's Canadian operations?
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I sincerely appreciate the question coming from the member who I know has intimate relations with those affected by this situation. And it is a tragedy. And it is why the Government of Ontario has stepped forward to protect the interests of the workers and the pensioners from the very beginning. And we will continue to do so. As the member obviously knows, the The government has been working with the company. We know that what we want to achieve is the best possible outcome for the pensioners. It is before the courts. There are procedures that are taking place, and we're going to work towards doing everything possible to support the people of Hamilton and, more importantly, the pensioners and those we know that are being affected. And we are arm in arm to try to do everything we can to protect their interests. Thank you.
Mr. Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Minister, the Speaker, through to the Speaker, to you, the pensioners who put 30 to 40 years of their lives deserve every penny of what U.S. Steel owes them. These employees agreed in good faith their part of their compensation would be in the form of company pension contributions, that is, Minister, deferred wages, which they negotiated. They accepted lower wages then as part of their deal, and now U.S. Steel is effectively trying to steal the remainder of their wages and their benefits and their retirement security. This is theft, Minister. So how is this government going to protect those pensioners? I'm not sure. And what is this government doing to ensure that any future foreign-owned guarantees that pension funds will be there when needed for the people of Ontario, for the people of Canada, question, that they will be protected in their retirement?
The member, I believe, knows that Ontario is the only province in Canada that actually has a pension guaranteed fund to protect those that are affected in the case of bankruptcies, which is what's occurring here today. So it is before the courts. Processes are in their way. He should also know, and I think the people of Ontario know, that the government of Ontario also provided support by way of loans to enable that company to continue to provide its services for the benefit of the pensioners. And that's also a question. So we're all at the table. We all recognize that everyone's being affected, and we're trying to minimize the adverse effects of that process. Please stay in touch with us. And I appreciate the ongoing discussions that we've had over the last number of months on this issue. We want to support the pensioners and the people of Ontario who are affected by this. Thank you,
Mr. Speaker. Your question? The member from Etobicoke Lakeshore.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities. Minister, post-secondary education is a big investment for Ontario families. And with the start of the new school year, many students in my riding of Etobicoke Lakeshore and throughout the province want to know about the different financial aid programs that are available to them to complete their studies. I understand that Ontario has one of the most generous student financial assistance programs in Canada. When we entered office in 2003, almost zero grant programs were in place for students. But we've worked hard to make the financial aid system more progressive. Now, low and middle income students pay substantially less than they did just 10 years ago. Minister, can you please inform the members of the House on how our government is making post-secondary education more affordable and accessible for students across Ontario?
Thank you, Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for that question, the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore. Mr. Speaker, our government is committed to ensuring that our students in Ontario, they have access to best quality of post-secondary education, and post-secondary education is accessible, affordable, based on their ability to learn, not on their ability to pay. That's why we have made a number of key investments to help make our post-secondary education more accessible and affordable to our young people. Mr. Speaker, last year we invested $1.3 billion in grants and loans for our students across the province of Ontario. 70% of that funding was non-repayable by the students. Mr. Speaker, we capped tuition fees increases by 3%, which saves students about $1,200 over 4 years. And this year,
answer,
the 30% off tuition grant will help students save up to $1,000 in
great
tuition fees. When, Mr. Speaker, you come.
Thank you.
Thank
here,
you.
Here.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for that answer. It's reassuring to know that our government remains committed to supporting students across post-secondary education on the basis of their ability to learn and not to pay. Many students in my riding of Etobicoke Lakeshore heavily rely on the Ontario Student Aid Program to cover the costs of their post-secondary tuition. And I understand that more than 380,000, more than half of all full-time students, received financial aid last year alone. Minister, when our government passed the 2015 budget, I was happy to learn that
We were in fact announcing several changes to the OSAP program that will provide additional financial support to students attending college or university. Minister, can you please inform the members of the House about the most recent changes to the Ontario Student Aid Program that were announced in the 2015 budget?
Thank you, Minister.
Mr. Speaker, again, I want to thank the member from Etobicoke Lakeshore for that question. Mr. Speaker, we are modernizing OSAP by indexing the maximum student loan limit to inflation, helping students save up to $1,000. We are launching the Ontario Student Loan Rehabilitation Program. We are also capping student debt to not more than $7,400 per two-term year. We are also making OSAP assessment process more transparent and more easier for our students, exempting vehicle from as an asset, also giving students an option to take out as much as loan as they can, not the full maximum of loan. Also, we're exempting the first $3,000 in student assets. Mr. Speaker, when you are taking into account the tuition fees in Ontario and those assistance, financial assistance, which students receive from the government, the tuition, the cost of post-secondary education in Ontario is one of the lowest in this country, and we are very proud of that, Mr. Speaker. We have learned and listened to our students, and we have acted based on their recommendations. That's why we have modernized it.
Thank you for your question, the Minister of Bruce Rio and Sound.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister of Health. A constituent in my riding needs two surgeries, but neither surgery can be done unless she receives physiotherapy treatment first to regain mobility. Minister, your rules say because she is 53 years old and not on ODSP, she does not qualify and has to wait 12 years before she can access physiotherapy. Will you address this concern, and will you be straight with the people of Ontario and tell them why there is money for Liberal friends and scandals, but no money for the many Ontarians who need access to rehabilitation services?
That's a good question.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question from the member opposite, and I think, or I would certainly hope that the member knows that the changes that we made recently, a couple of years back,
in fact,
the result of that was it doubled the number of publicly funded physiotherapy funding, doubled the number of physiotherapy clinics, publicly funded physiotherapy clinics in the province. And, and in addition to that, we expanded the coverage not simply to include those clinics, but to specifically target our seniors. And I think the member opposite would appreciate the importance of that, to where 200,000 additional seniors in this province are receiving publicly funded physiotherapy services as a result of those changes that we made. But Mr. Speaker, as well, we rely on our CCACs to make that determination, to be the single point, if you will,
answer,
of access and determination for, with regards to a patient's needs, including for physiotherapy.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Back to the Minister of Health. And what we do know is that lots of people are going without care. Here's the truth. You've been laying off nurses, you're axing medical residency spaces, and you're cutting funding for surgeries, diabetic strips, and physiotherapy treatments. Minister, will you stand up today and give Ontarians an honest answer? Will you say why you're denying my constituent and many others access to physio and surgery across this great province?
Minister.
The member opposite knows that his constituents, for example, in Owen Sound, up until a couple of years ago, had to travel to London for their physiotherapy services. But as a result of the changes that we made, there's now publicly funded physiotherapy services existing in Owen Sound, Mr. Speaker. These are the types of changes that we've made to benefit the people, not of his, just of his constituents, not just of his riding, but across the province. And we've increased the funding to physiotherapy by $156 million. We're investing rather $156 million annually to expand those services to those who need them. But again, we rely on our CCACs to make that individual determination with regard to an individual's need for physiotherapy services, services now that are publicly available in Owen Sound.
The member from Cambridge on a point of order.
Speaker, I wanted to introduce a couple of guests today in the members gallery. It's the mother and grandmother of my great legislative assistant, Leo Lehman. So we've got Debbie Lehman and Penny Ray in the gallery with us. Please welcome them to Queen's Park.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I ask all members of the legislature to join me in welcoming Page Captain Grace Molly Sankva's mother, Jackie Shui, who's in the gallery today.
Welcome.
We have a deferred vote on the motion of second reading of Bill 52, an act to amend the Courts of Justice Act, the Libel and Slander Act, and the Statutory Powers Procedure Act in order to protect expressions of matter of public interest. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bill.
Would all members please take their seats? You're not the last. I always watch to see who wants to be the last.
I don't believe you. You're always pulling my leg.
On December 10th, 2014, Madame Mulier moves second reading of Bill 52. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Madame Mulier.
Madame Mulier.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandel.
Mr. Dugan.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Rinaldi.
Ms. Reneal.
Mr. Tebow.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Bisson. Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Ms. DeNovo. Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jolinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester. Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Montauk.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mrs. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. Campbell.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Brown. Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
The ayes being 87 and the nays being 8, I declare the motion carried.
You have the bill. Deuxième lecture du projet de loi.
Pursuant to the order of the House dated June 2, 2015, the bill is ordered referred to the Standing Committee on Justice Policy. We have a deferred vote on the motion, a second reading of Bill 37, an act respecting invasive species. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell. Thank you. On December 8, 2014, Mr. Morrow moves second reading of Bill 37. All those in favor, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley. Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Rossetti.
Mr. Rossetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Pratt.
Mr. Pratt.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Jassic.
Ms. Jassic.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. Thibault.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hilliard.
Mr. Hilliard.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantal.
Mr. Vantal.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
The ayes are 95, the nays are 0.
The ayes being 95, the nays being 0, I declare the motion carried.
Second reading of the bill, deuxième lecture, projet de loi.
Pursuant to the order of the House dated June 2, 2015, the bill is ordered referred to the Standing Committee on Social Policy. There are no further deferred votes. I am going to recognize the Minister of Training Colleges and Universities.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to correct my record. In my remarks, I mentioned that our 30% off tuition grant saves students up to $1,000. In fact, it does save students up to $1,830.
80% increase.
Thank you. As we all know, members are allowed to correct their own record, and that is appropriate. There will be no deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.